Hello, welcome back to Being True Love, being the best version of yourself by understanding development and thoughts is what this video is about. Please subscribe if you are watching. Please keep an open mind and try to remember that when the student is ready, the teacher appears. No one is better than anyone else. We are all students of each other. So, you may be sitting there watching this video wondering, why do I need to know this? Well, understanding the way that humans develop is important for humans to know so that humans who wish to make changes in the world can start using this kind of information to make changes in themselves. Being the change you wish to see in the world is the only way to really change the world. Through understanding the way that humans develop, humans are able to recognize how their own development has helped or hindered decisions in their own life. And with that knowledge and understanding of one's own development, humans can, one, decide to do things differently when they're raising their own children or any children they're helping raise or develop. And two, humans can use the understanding of how humans develop to redevelop and or make changes in themselves. So the more you understand, the more powerful you become. Knowledge really is power. So for starters, research reveals that the best scenario for a developing human is to do so with a secure attachment. There are many attachment styles, and we'll research those many attachment styles in another video. But like I mentioned, having a secure attachment is the leading and best way to ensure that a human develops properly. You can research attachment styles and attachment on your own if you like. Each attachment style results in a certain behavior for a human. Secure attachments lead to humans who establish a healthy self-concept and a high level of self-esteem. I think we all know just how important it is to have a healthy self-esteem and a good self-perception. One of the most important things to know about humans is that they develop in stages. Did you know that not many decades ago, humans pretty much believed that children were just a smaller version of an adult who simply did not have experience? Now, ain't that wild? During slavery and after slavery, there were tons of displaced, misplaced, and or lost black children all over America and all over the world. In America, the gruesome ideologies, prejudice, disrespect, selling, enslavement, and inhumane treatment of black Americans was responsible for the breaking up of many black families and led to the creation of homes exclusively for black children. Just a few seconds into this short video, we'll show you what these homes look like. I'll stop the video at about 53 seconds and we'll continue our discussion after that. So let's see. Here it comes. It takes a minute to start.
The Colored Orphan Asylum was an institution in New York City opened from 1836 to 1946 that housed on average 400 children annually and was mostly managed by women. Its first location was on 5th Avenue between 42nd and 43rd Street, a four-story building with two wings. The Colored Orphan Asylum was founded in 1836 by three Quakers, Anna and Hannah Shotwell and Mary Lindley Murray. It was one of the first of its kind in the United States to take in black children whose parents had died or were not able to take care of them. In 1846, Dr. James McCune Smith, the country's first licensed African-American medical doctor, became the orphanage's medical director. The orphanage moved several times in Manhattan. 1863.
Okay, so that was just a good depiction of it. I think so anyway. But the colored home for children was not the only mass boarding structure that housed children by the hundreds. Okay, by the hundreds. These housing developments were called orphan asylums, workhouses,
riots,
almshouses, and or poorhouses. That's another name for them. And they were all over the world. I did a simple search on YouTube for videos of orphanages, and in the picture you can see my results. If you notice, the search returned videos of full footage from places all over the world. Vietnam, Ireland, the Philippines, Nepal, the Sahara, and of course, many other places. We can probably imagine that some of these mass housing developments were better than others. But overall, all the classes of persons who have special protections today, such as the disabled, the elderly, and children, could also be found in an institution of this type. If you were not simply and or completely rich for some reason, or part of what was established to be a royal family, you were simply poor. If you were an orphan or some other type of displaced human or even a criminal who was placed into servitude as punishment, you would find shelter in a workhouse or almshouse and live there daily doing work of all sorts. And yes, labor and work of all sorts, okay? Obviously, for development, we can imagine that these orphanages worldwide and workhouses were not the best place for children to develop and thrive. In the film Oliver Twist, the author and filmmakers did their best to recapture just how horrible these places were for children. Take a look here at this quick 10-second video clip.
Please, sir, I want some more.
What? 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 Ask for more?
Sad. Some of these institutions would also educate and train. Many of these types of Many of these types of institutions went on to become high schools, residential colleges, boarding schools, or reform and or correctional institutions that we know of today. In America, things were slightly different because white humans who broke away from the rest of the world, primarily away from British rule, declared their independence and were able to create this idea that only blacks should be reduced to labor. They flooded the American continent with this blacks are inferior idea. At some other time, we can go over how this inferior race idea was used against other races as well, and even written into laws like in the 1854 People versus Hall case, where a California judge scribed that an Asian man could not testify against a white man, stating the reason being that the Asian race was inferior. It was just a hot mess. But early into it, when they first began to take over America, whites were able to get some of the Native Americans aligned with this idea, and many Native American tribes began to release white servants and hoard only blacks as servants and slaves as well. Prehistory shows that prior to that era, black slaves were actually less in number, as a majority of blacks either were of royal bloodline or were highly respected as educators, knowledge bearers, architects, doctors, and persons informed in the ways of cleanliness, sanitation, and civilization. You can research the Moors or the Moreños more simply. The word Moor just simply means black. And you can research that more on your own. You can also research Nubia and the Kingdom of Kush, or of course you can go back and do like your research on ancient Egypt times to gather an understanding of why blacks were actually held in high regard prior to the push of Christianity and the black inferior race idea. Overall, This is why moving toward a primarily black servant-slave world took centuries of time and tearing down of history, facts, and generally black people as a whole. To this day, one has a hard time obtaining true history on more knowledge and teachings. In this next video about Moorish living, you would not know anything about their race if you did not know that the Moors were black. But we still get a very good depiction of how civilized and knowledgeable the Moors were. And this is the reason why they and other blacks were both highly respected and heavily envied. They traveled the world teaching architecture, sanitation, mathematics, and just about everything else you can think of. I'd say it is no coincidence why the Portuguese were the first to force blacks into slavery. Moors were highly sought after in all lands, while other humans tried to force the Moors to use their knowledge of masonry and expertise and everything else to create civilizations similar to the civilized way that the Moors lived. So let's watch this quick video. And again, as I mentioned, you wouldn't even know what they look like if you just heard the video. It's kind of not misleading, but it's just kind of goes along with that ideology that kind of history about blacks is heavily suppressed. But overall, it gives you a good depiction still on how they live. So here we go. It's just 3 minutes.
Moorish Palace. Nowhere else does the splendor of that civilization, Al-Andalus.
I'm sorry, let's start it from the beginning.
The story of Granada is all about the Islamic Moors. In the year 711, these North African Muslims crossed the Straits of Gibraltar and quickly conquered the entire Iberian Peninsula, eventually converting most of its inhabitants. Throughout the Middle Ages, for over 700 years, Spain was a predominantly Muslim society living under Muslim rule.
And that age shapes today's sightseeing agenda. Granada's dominant site is the Alhambra, the last and greatest Moorish palace. Nowhere else does the splendor of that civilization, Al-Andalus, shine so brightly. For 2 centuries, until 1492, Granada reigned as the capital of a dwindling Moorish empire. As Christian forces pushed the Moors further and further south, this palace was the last hurrah of a sophisticated civilization. While the rest of Europe slumbered through much of the Middle Ages, the Moorish civilization was wide awake. The math necessary to construct this palace would have dazzled Europeans at that age.
The Moors made great gains in engineering, medicine, even classical Greek studies. In fact, some of the great thinking of ancient Greece had been forgotten by Europe, but was absorbed into Islam and actually given back to Europe via scholars here in Spain.
The culture of the Moors was exquisite, artfully combining both design and aesthetics. Facing a reflecting pond, the Hall of the Ambassadors was the throne room. It was here that the Sultan, seated Oz-like, received foreign emissaries. Its wooden ceiling illustrates a command of geometry. With 8,000 pieces inlaid like a giant jigsaw puzzle, it symbolizes the complexity of Allah's infinite universe. Arabic calligraphy, mostly poems and verses of praise from the Quran, is everywhere. Muslims avoid making images of living creatures. That's God's work. But decorating with religious messages is fine. One phrase, "Only God is victorious," is repeated 9,000 times throughout the Alhambra. Like the Sultan, we can escape from the palace into what was the most perfect Arabian garden in Andalusia. This royal summer retreat, lush and bursting with water, was the closest thing on earth to the Quran's description of heaven. In fact, its name, the Generalife, meant essentially that, the Garden of Paradise. Water, so rare and precious in most of the Islamic world, was the purest symbol of life, whether providing for its 2,000 thirsty residents, masking secret conversations, or just flowing playfully. Water was integral to the space the Alhambra created.
For centuries, Europe struggled to push the Moors back into Africa. This campaign was called the Reconquista. Finally, in 14...
So I'll stop it there. You're welcome to go back and look on your own. As you can see, it's called the Granada, Spain, the exquisite Alhambra. But let's continue moving forward with our video.
1492.
So whites began to kidnap and buy blacks straight from Africa. Some were purchased from prestigious African kings as well. They needed them to oppress so that they can be free, but also they needed their knowledge and skills. For example, African fractals is the language of computers today. You can research that on your own as well. It's pretty hard to go into these topics without the inner details, but moving right along. So for Native Americans, we can conclude and assume that maybe this cooperation with whites enslaving blacks was, to them, the smart and safe thing to do, since many Native Americans had dark skin tones as well, some even being black themselves, like the Seminole Native Americans, the Shinnecock Native Americans, and many more. And I'm not suggesting that the Seminoles or any other black, Mexican, or Hispanic tribes had slaves. I'm saying that many of the non-black Native Americans may have found it convenient for them as a way to keep hold over their own estates and land. If you notice that even today, the majority of recognized Native American tribes have white-looking skin, while the majority of Native Americans on the continent when Columbus arrived and on what they called the good ship Jesus, or Jesus of Lubbock, that was the name of the ship, were dark skinned, which is why he thought he was in India and called them what later became a derogatory name known as simply Indian. So either way, of course not all Native Americans participated. We know the story of some, like the Native American man known as Crazy Horse, who after the slaves were free, continued on a hunt for white settlers. Overall, before, during, and after slavery, many Native Americans did cooperate, but that alignment did not serve them well for too long. Eventually, whites began to desire more human slaves as property, more power, and more land. We all know of the genocide, the conniving history of fake peace treaties, and trickery on until they turned against the Native Americans completely and just came right out with the Indian Removal Act, leading to the sad story of the Trail of Tears that Native Americans suffered through. You're welcome to research this topic on your own as well, or we can go deeper in another video about that history some other time. Elsewhere in the world, most but not every place, monarchs continue to rule, and the mimetic or idea that only certain families have the divine right to rule remained as the primary belief. See, kings and queens are said to be a person ordained by God to rule. Otherwise, one can also become king through battle and overthrowing a king through success at war. Take a quick listen for about 30 seconds of this video's description of what a king or how a king should be.
As the king is overlord of the whole land, so is he master over every person that inhabiteth the same, having power over the life and death of every one of them. For although a just prince will not take the life of any of his subjects without a clear law, yet the same laws are made by himself or his predecessors, and so the power flows always from himself.
So that's a pretty good description, right? So if you're not a king, then, or a queen, or if you're not of that bloodline, you were just pretty much, sucks to be you. And you were a servant. So everyone of all colors continued to be in servitude, while America continued to become known as the place where whites can go and become free. In America, the Declaration of Independence was written against the King of England, and this document delivered thousands of people out of servitude. The authors asserted their independence, but they also needed and wanted servants and slaves to serve them as well. One thing we can find in human development is repetitive behavior or learned behavior. See, those who were oppressed did not simply desire to be free. They more wanted to be at the top and on the better side of the oppression and servant game, if you will. There's a really good book called The Pedagogy of the Oppressed by Paulo Freire, whereby the word pedagogy means teachings. So it's basically called the teachings of the oppressed. But the book talks about this concept of how the oppressed desire to become the oppressor rather than truly equalize and or demolish an oppressive way of living. Sorry, just a moment, got the wrong slide. There we go. So back to those who came to America to free themselves. Well, they spread the ideology that only blacks should be servants. They made up this mimetic or meme long before they actually became independent. This idea was generational and took centuries to work itself out. They first needed to define God as looking more like them so that they could create the understanding that they were at liberty to assert that they should not be servants. For centuries, they spread the word, and about 11 years after they succeeded in their independence, they further established what is known as the Constitution. And in the Constitution, they continued to produce the ideology that blacks were only 3/4 of a human to make their rule and reason for having servants, black servants, easier for everyone to accept and buy into. They also did this to justify their grotesque, inhumane, and cruel treatment of black slaves. In a documentary called The Slave Narratives, actors and actresses read from the narratives of actual slaves. And you can see here in this short video clip how they used religion, specifically Christianity, the same way they did for centuries when creating this racial divide. So we're going to watch. I'm just going to start at the 33 minute mark and go from there. So I remember it was at about 33 that I wanted to show. So let me just fast forward it. It was about at 33, something like that. We'll take it from about right here.
But to sell any in town, they'd have to get a pass to go. They had to go at night because they couldn't have a spare hand from the fields.
We got one pair of shoes a year. When they wore out, we went barefooted. Sometimes we tied them up with strings, and they were so raggedy that the tracks looked like bird tracks when we walked in the road. My brother wore his shoes out and had none all through the winter. His feet cracked open and bled so bad you could track him by the blood.
Get up, children, run down. Don't go turning down for none. Get up, children.
Well, I remember quite well how those poor children used to have to eat. They were fed in boxes and troughs under the house. They were fed cornmeal mush and beans. When this was poured into their box, they would gather around it, the same as we see pigs, horses, and cattle gather around troughs today.
Oh, us never got enough to eat. So us keep stealing stuff. Us had to.
Of course we know that it was wrong to steal, but the niggas had to steal to get something to eat. I know I did. I got so hungry I steal chickens off their roosts. Yes, some I did. Chickens used to roost on the fence stand right out in the night. We cook the chicken at night, eat him, and burn the fellas.
They talks a heap about the niggas stealing. Well, you know what was the first stealing done? It was in Africa, when the white folks stole the niggas just like you'd go get a drove of horses and sell them. But since the Lord saved me from a life of sin, I don't think about them things.
Who tell you?
The first enslaved people in America were reluctant to accept the religion of their masters, but during the 19th century, thousands of slaves began turning to Christianity. They infused this adopted religion with a new spirituality and with African traditions. Many owners hoped that Christianity might make their slaves more docile and encourage them to convert.
On Sundays, niggas had to sit and listen to the white man's sermon. Obey your master, be good servant. Can't tell you how many times I done heard that text preached on. They tell a slave that if he be good, work hard for his master, that he would go to heaven and that he gonna live a life of ease. They ain't never tell you he'll be free in heaven.
So we'll stop it there, but overall, as you can see here in this short video clip, they use religion, specifically Christianity, the same way that they did for centuries when creating this racial divide as a whole. They did this as a way to get into the minds of blacks for easier submission from them and as a way to have more control over them. These narratives were actual interviews of slaves, and you can read or research actual slave narratives on your own by visiting the Library of Congress online. You can also view the film of the slave narratives for free on YouTube. So, America became the dream of many whites who were otherwise servants. Themselves, if they were not somehow wealthy or part of a royal bloodline, wherever you were in the world, servant or not, you could come to America and essentially be king if you were white. Many were not even racist but wanted the lifestyle, while of course there were others who actually believed the hype. In present day, the ideology and mimetic is still unraveling. So if you can imagine, people navigated to the Americas in droves so that they can leave their life of labor and enslavement behind and oppress their life of labor, poverty, and servitude onto black and brown people. White freedom became dependent on oppressing blacks, as well as dependent on the ability for a white person to establish land and, above all else, their own tent in that era, and later home ownership, as housing technology advanced to more modern times so that they had a place where they can establish the luxury of being served rather than being a servant, a place of their own, a small castle or house to carry out their American dream in. This is where much of the horrid and rotten ways associated with racism became a priority and means of survival for them. I imagine that over generations, the ideology to hate blacks was just a byproduct of this new freedom. I bet the majority have no clue why they felt the way they felt against blacks in general, but it became sewn into their freedom. In and of the universe, there is only love and fear. It is fair to conclude that their fear of returning to servitude became the fuel for them to oppress, belittle, marginalize, harm, and enslave blacks overall. Also, there were still many who remained as servants on American lands, either as criminals sentenced because of poverty or other reasons, and they continued to live in servitude the same way they would have in previous land for the remainder of their life as well. Just as there was places all over the world who picked up this black slave narrative as well. In fact, Portugal, as I mentioned earlier, was the first to have Africans as slaves. We have to consider all those possibilities when reflecting on history, while we also need to know the central conflicts relevant to our topic. Now, with all that said, let us fast forward to after slavery on through to the era right before people realized that the development of children should be the focus. These orphanages, almshouses, asylums, and workhouses housed children by the hundreds, as mentioned. There was a famous comic who created the character Orphan Annie as a way to show and share the experience of this era. The comic later became a very popular Broadway play, and what was his name? I think his name was Gray. I think it's, yes, it's a, the comic's last name was Gray, who created Orphan Annie. The comic later became a very popular Broadway play, and later on a film. So let's look at a short, fun parody video clip of this, and keep an eye out for how the era and lifestyle is represented in this film. This is why I love theater arts, because how else might we really experience certain parts of human history?
I love you, Miss Hannigan.
Why any kid would want to be an orphan is beyond me.